I'm sorry to break this to you at this particular time, but God, he doesn't exist. Not anymore. The only God now is physics. Nothing is beyond its reach. Like chaos theory. Chaos theory now posits the idea that between all extremes there is a point of balance, but that this point is so infinitesimal, so small, that you can't actually measure it. You can never actually find out where it is. All we know is that this point exists somewhere between hot and cold on my shower unit. And it's not like I'm not patient with it, you know. I stand there while cold, pneumonia-creating icicles rain down on my naked back, turning the dial so slowly from blue to red. So slowly, sometimes I think I've died. And then suddenly it's bugger shit, piss, wang! Oh, yes, great. I never wanted skin anyway. It's beautiful, though, to see this kind of devastatingly complex physics put into practice in the day-to-day universe. Like those T-shirts that change colour with the temperature. Fantastic. Because I like people to know when I'm a bit hot. You know, as if great big sweat patches under my arms aren't enough, I've now got to wear a T-shirt that advertises the fact that I now smell like a piece of brie. It's like having pants that light up when you skidded them. God is left behind by all this, creeping along behind the physicists saying, sorry, I don't quite understand. But the church, they screwed up from the word go. From the moment they decided that the best form of decor for them was gargoyles, right? So the audiovisual experience of being in church is like, welcome to this haven of God's love in his mercy. A place of peace where the mind may rest in tranquility. But then sometimes I yearn for something beyond physics. I yearn for the existence of something or someone better.
Sir John of Tewkesbury.
And what's your job?
I am the Witchfinder General.
And what car are you thinking of?
The Eight of Clubs.
We say the magic words, hocus pocus, hanky panky, and here it is. Would you mind opening this envelope, please? What card is within?
It is the Eight of Clubs.
Now, there's no way I can have known that, is there?
No, there is no way. Seize him! In domine patris et spirito sanctum, be it known that on this, the most holy of seasons, Paul Daniels did reveal himself to be hey, witch!
No, no, I've got, like, loads of other cards up in my pocket in my sleeve!
Dissembler! And that he did conjure to the devil using the forbidden words hocus pocus hanky panky. What shall his fate be?
Sometimes I read the text of the Bible and it moves me like nothing else, you know. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In the beginning was the Word. Well, I can't believe the first thing God invented was Terry Christian, you know. Even if he's a relative. And sometimes, unasleep at night, I read how once in another time, physics was truly defeated.
Behold, I have turned the water into wine.
Ta-da!
In my search for an actual miracle, I heard that in this small church in the Shetland Isles, there's a statue of the Virgin Mary, which local people have sworn they've seen move. Now, I'm a skeptic. I wouldn't normally believe such things, weeping blood from the eyes, stigmata, whatever. But something about this story gave me hope. I took Robert with me to see if a miracle could convert us both. Merry Christmas.
I am your poltergeist. I know, I'll switch the telly on. And then when they come back, one of them will say, "But I switched it off." And the other one will say, "Yes, you did. What's going on?" They'll be frightened and confused and... Oh, blimey, that's a bit scary. Oh, I can't look. Oh, that's better. Good Lord, that was way before the watershed. Let me see. Dear points of view, is there really any need to show modern so-called horror films when children of any age might be watching? I think it's disgusting. Yours sincerely, Poltergeist.
I was down the cafe about yesterday, and this bloke called me over. His arm was in a sling, and he said, could I undo his sugar sachet and stir his tea? So I stirred his tea. He said, thanks. I said, no problem. Went and sat down about two tables away. And I was thinking, you know, if this was France or up north, maybe, I'd be able to just, like, shoot the breeze then for a bit, then, you know, just how did you break your arm, that. So I tried talking to him, but I couldn't. I was like... But I kept trying, so I was thinking, if I can just talk to him now, London is less of a lonely place. So I was like... Couldn't, but I kept on. I was like... And then someone came and stirred my tea. Sorry, I was getting a bit tense there. I feel some painting coming on. Doesn't seem like long ago I was doing this one. Just do the red side of the cart. As the paint runs, rather than get het up about the paint running, I'm imagining that it's oiling those wheels. It's already become more of an adventure than a bit of paint. There had to be this wooden bit of the cart bed as well. The old cart. That's going to let me down. R.D. Lang recommends, when you're depressed, thinking back to a time when you were happier. And for most people who live in London, that time is before we moved here. So I was thinking about it. I was thinking, you know, I used to live in Liverpool and I was real happy there, and I should go and visit the people I knew when I lived up there. So I was packing my bags and I was thinking, as you do in those situations, you know, why is it, why have I left it so long since I visited them last? And I think it's because Everyone I know in Liverpool, I don't just know them, I know, like, their families as well. So I know their mums and dads, no problem there. But I also know their grannies. I never know what you do, etiquette-wise, with grannies. You do, like, hug them, do you shake hands, do you kiss? If so, is it both cheeks? So I usually, I think, I'll go for the kiss, but I'm not confident about it, so I'm a bit clumsy and I'm nervous, and I end up sticking my tongue in her ear, and it's... Better to stay back. But I thought, no, forget all that trivia. You know, I'm going to Liverpool. So I was in the car and I'm driving up the motorway and I've got the radio on and I'm feeling good, feel like I'm making the right move. And suddenly,
this is an announcement for anybody in the south of England heading north on the M1 or M62. Piss off, you southern bastard.
Now, there is no need for 40% of all sitting down for a quiet read accidents to happen. There was no need for that to happen.
When we attempt a retrospective of Leon Capaldi's work, we can see a central conflict. He was, on the one hand, a symbolist film director, conveying subtle meaning through images, and on the other hand, a desperately unconfident, neurotic man, terrified of being misunderstood. His first film, called Ring Any Bells? Ostensibly a tale about a tough new management regime taking over a production line, has been seen by some more perceptive critics as an allegory of the events in Germany leading up to the Second World War.
Right. From now on, there will be no disagreements. Everything shall be done as I say, and only as I say. And some of you are going to be kicked out. Show of hands.
On moving to Hollywood in the mid-1950s, Capaldi's first studio production, Catch My Drift, was a romantic drama about a woman singer from the Canary Islands trapped in a loveless marriage.
Don't you understand? This marriage has crushed me. I want to leave.
You can't, Maria. You know you can't. And you never will. I shall expect you here when I return, Maria. Which shall be at a time of my choosing.
Oh. Capaldi's 1967 classic, Comprende? A film full of the liberated spirit of the time includes a now notorious scene in which the erotic undercurrent between a man and a woman is entirely conveyed through the medium of a game of chess, for the most part.
I have taken your queen.
It will soon be mate. Your knight is in the center of my rear guard.
In the 1970s, Capaldi worked for a while with Steven Spielberg. They fell out, however, after an argument during the making of Jaws, the music for which Capaldi felt to be too ambiguous.
Sharky, Sharky. Sharky swimming under the water. Coming this way. Sharky, 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 Sharky. It's a shark. Sharky, shark. Sharky, shark, 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 shark.
Ooh.
Hello, tonight I'm joined by writer, structuralist critic and filmmaker Paul Brenton.
Hello.
Paul, I wonder if I could begin tonight's discussion with a question, a simple question perhaps, but one which I feel at this late stage in the century should be asked, indeed needs to be asked, and that is, are you or are you not, in a very real sense, looking at me?
Well, this is very interesting, because, and I understand your reasons for asking the question, I do understand them, but I would have to say, given the circumstances in which we find ourselves, I would have to answer, yes, I am looking at you. What, in essence, are you going to do about it?
Well, given what you say, how can I put it? Beyond this interior, indeed the environment which constitutes the exterior, that which lies around our present arena and forms all that we call external. In other words, outside.
Yes, I think I would have to say, and I hope you'll forgive me for saying this, what exactly is the identity of the general and or field marshal, urban militia head, what you will, who exactly is in charge of the armed force who will be assisting you in this endeavour?
I'm sorry, I haven't quite understood you. Or, to put it another way, you what?
Moving on, is it not the case, do you think, that the woman who I think it would be accurate to describe as your bird, she is she not, a slag?
I take your point, and I would have to add, in an entirely ironical and satirical fashion, that you have now got me in a state where I'm soiling my underpants.
Paul, we must keep in a frame of reference the fact that your actions have cast a wholly negative pallor over what is, after all, my 21st birthday party.
One must remember that as chaos theory posits, everything is interconnected. That is, you cannot just hit him, you must then also hit his brother. And then we're talking south of the river. Bish-bosh, na-na, clunk, 5 years.
You are essentially moribund. You have assured your imminent fatality.
You are entirely discourse, discourse, discourse.
Well, hello. I've become involved with the charity Crisis at Christmas. They recently appealed for anyone who had a bed for the thousands of homeless young strays sleeping rough on the streets of Soho. Well, it's going to be a bit of a squeeze. Actually, I'm sure the young tearaways and runaways will find Christmas at Jarvis Mansions a little bit humdrum. For the last 6 weeks, I have done nothing except play ping pong by the fireside. I become something of a dab hand, as I have a serving machine that fires 7 ping pong balls at a time at me. A quite wonderful serving machine. I first met her in Thailand. And do you know, in all the 6 weeks she's been firing table tennis balls at me, I haven't managed to return a single one. Or even buy a table tennis set. Nevertheless, I do feel rather good to be doing my little bit for the stray denizens of the parish, the homeless. I don't want to come over all Mother Teresa. Oh, God. Oh, that would be awful. Well, imagine if she just had a clean tea towel on her. Oh, God. That would make me just about the most despicable man in the world. Oh, my giddy aunt. Well, hello. That's a very nice sleeping bag you have there. It's the same colour as my smoking jacket. Or it would be if I'd spent a week rolling around in mud and urine. Oh, dear. Well, that's the last thing I want to happen. Happy New Year. See you around.
Here they are, Albert.
Okay, don't worry. He should be all right now. We'll keep him in for observation. It's just at his age, a compound fracture of the leg can have complications.
Thank you very much for driving me in, Mr. Newman. Mr. Vladibug, it was very kind of you.
So will you be all right to do another show?
Well, actually, Mr. Newman, I was going to tell you, I'm not going to do any more shows.
Oh, really? Albert, there it is.
Thank you. You see, Mr. Newman, Mr. Vladibug, I finally managed to save up enough money, and I bought my daughter Sally a dialysis machine.
Oh, right.
Oh, brilliant.
One other thing. There. Would you take it down to the car park, please? Well, boys, if I may call you that, thank you so much. I would have liked a few more lines to speak here and there, and I haven't always understood your skits. Oh, they're very good, I'm sure. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you, no, really.
It's all
really
been worth it.
No. Hey, Albert. God bless.
Yeah, good luck.
Not streetwise, you know. I've been accused by people who seem to have some sort of hearing disorder of being a pseudo-cockney. Well, that is just complete drill and bit, yeah? I've always been entirely middle class. The only time I notice my accent dropping a few H's is when I'm approached by someone who might be considered to be the tiniest bit hard.
Oi, excuse me, mate. Got the time?
You want to know the time? You want to know the old nursery rhyme? Well, I'll tell you, but first of all, my old man's dustman, he wears dusty pants, he wears more bloody trousers, he lives in a council flat. Fatty pasta skinny. Oh!
I'll tell you another street nightmare. Seeing someone who you know in the street approaching about 100 yards away from you. Because after your eyes have met for the first time, what are you supposed to do with your face? You know, there are only so many gestures of recognition in the book. So after a while, you just end up walking down the street going...
And welcome to what I have been told, in rather unnecessarily forceful language, is to be the last ever History Today. I am completely at a loss as to why this should be. However, as a partisan shot, both myself and Professor F.J. Lewis are on our mettle to render such a sterling debate as to make them, as in Aleppo once, regret their rather hasty and ill-informed decision. We have chosen for our sterling debate the history of Christmas. Professor Lewis, do you concur with A.N. Wilson that the dating of the festival period has more to do with pagan and Roman feast days than with Judaic historical actuality?
See a bird that the cat's brought in and that's had its head bitten off.
Is it still flapping a bit?
Yes, one muddy wing, and it's bleeding all over the carpet.
I have seen such a poor, desperate animal.
That's your turkey, that is. With all the trimmings. Oh, beautiful. Really beautiful. You're spending Christmas on your own.
No, you are. And Professor Lewis, might I remind you, this is the last ever of our broadcasts, and we are discussing a sacred text. After all, after exegesis ends, we should remember that the strength of the Christian myth lies in its simplicity. And perhaps only the painters remember this, as they paint and repaint the simple image of a woman surrounded by three men, a donkey and a sheep.
I am aware of the eternal tableau.
And that's your mum's bedroom, that is. And then a sailor does it to her on the kitchen tableau. For £3.72.
The next person you see, you love.
Ooh. The Wentzless Lass myth is another good example of Christian apocrypha. That in the present condition of his...
It doesn't include me.
Oh, right. Well, in that case...
You love her. Too late with the hand. Too late with the hand. She wants to love you up. You better kiss and get married now.
You're spending Christmas on your own.
No, I'm spending Christmas with my niece and her family, and they've got, like, Sega and Michael Jordan videos.
You have to have stabilizers on your bike.
Everyone knows I do not have to use stabilizers. I am highly proficient on a bicycle.
Bicycle?
Bicycle.
Bicycle. You've got that word wrong. Because you can't speak English.
You can't even speak English at all because you live in an igloo.
Professor Lewis, if we could return to the discussion, perhaps it behoves us to remember that at Christmas, despite all the celebration, we still all at some point see the same image of a man with his head covered by twigs, waiting, waiting for 2,000 years, but always terribly, terribly alone.
I am aware of the mystical vision.
That's you under the mistletoe, that is.
Hello.
Ring, 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 ring. Hello. What's that you say? Oh, it's your niece.
No, I don't have a niece.
Oh, it's time now to open the presents. I see there's one here for you. To Professor F.J. Lewis, it says, love, Mum.
Oh.
Oh, dear, I see she's forgotten to take the price tag off. How much did they cost?
£3.72. Well, I haven't come on this programme to be insulted in a puerile way. My coat, please. I'm Emeritus Professor of History at All Souls College, Oxford, and I am above this level of immaturity. Good night.
Well, I don't think anyone should be in any doubt that tonight...
You see,
myself...
I don't need stabilisers. I'm Eddie Kidd.
Myself and Professor Lewis have had the most rigorous and intelligent...
I'm going to pop a wheelie now.